We just got a big thumbs up from the back of the room, ladies and gentlemen, and the word good, which means that this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. If we could call to order at 6:35, we're all just a couple of minutes late tonight for a whole host of reasons. You know, is this a welcome to spring snow has come upon us. Just everybody be a little more careful out there tonight, okay? It's going to be gone in a couple of days, but I was reminded this afternoon that the snow brush was no longer in one of our family members' cars.
Had that same conversation.
And a bicycle had replaced it. So yep. That said, you know, just take it a little easy out there today. We're going to go over minutes. We're going to talk a couple of updates with the board and the town administrator. And effectively, the next couple of meetings are going to be centered around warrant and the budget articles. The budget articles, Sherry's budget document. Sherry continues to work through some fine tuning. There are a couple of recommendations that are still coming. That's going to be from personnel as well as capital. And then that allows us to import that information to the warrant. And the warrant is slowly but surely tightening up. And I would imagine by our next meeting, we'll start seeing draft motions. Okay. So first up, minutes of 28th. I'm sorry. Two pages. What? 2.5 pages.
Were we that busy?
Wow. You can capture it.
I know.
When the votes are flying, it's easy, right? Then you look at the minutes and go, wow, we were efficient. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to approve the minutes of the 28th of March. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay, board updates.
Only thing I have is personnel committee tomorrow. For those things you mentioned. So.
Okay. And along the same vein, it's a meeting of the capital planning committee tomorrow night as well. Again, focus on the budget submission. Tom, anything?
First, it's kind of an announcement. Sophie Bashinsky had passed away earlier this year, and her family was going to and had put off the services until the spring. I got an email from Jan, Sophie's daughter, today to let me know that this coming Saturday is going to be her mom's service, that she was very specific, that the reception should be at the Pope John Paul II Hall on Sugar Loaf Street, with catering by the BBA from Thayer Street, and that Sophie, she loved the party and loved the party with good food. So Janet would like to let everyone know that there's going to be occurring on Saturday, that people that knew Sophie are all welcome, town officials are welcome to join in. It is spring. Get out of the house. Visit with the folks. And the timeline is it's going to be Saturday, April 9th at Risley's, 10 to 11 at visitation, 11 to 11:20. Father Caldwell from the Holy Name of Jesus Polish National Catholic Church will conduct a service. Then the family welcomes you to join them in a fellowship reception at the Holy Family Pope John Paul II Hall. After the services, family will join after graveside committal. So I had offered Jan that I would put that forward tonight, and she was grateful, and that if you knew Sophie, you'd like to remember and visit with the family Saturday, this coming Saturday. Second is I'd like to thank the people that put together the retirement surprise get together for Chief Gilbert. He was totally surprised. And I'd just like to thank them for the efforts that they made. Also, that we had a South County EMS informational hearing last Thursday in Whiteley, at the Whiteley Town Office Building. So we'd review certain aspects of the service, the budget, went over the budget, what it's doing. I think they're going to have one more scheduled in Deerfield, I think. They're before town meetings. And I think they went pretty well for the most part. So, but we're moving forward.
Okay. Town administrator update, Sherry. It's been quiet. Not much going on. Oh, wait. Annual town meeting. What's everything else?
We're busy. There's a lot going on, actually. Yeah. And I heard from the Lieutenant Governor's office on the community compact signing. And there's going to be a regional signing in Phillipston on May 17th at 9 o'clock.
Nice.
Get our own personal visit, huh?
No. They're, yeah.
Interesting.
The one other thing, if I could, Mr. Bergeron.
Sure.
Franklin County Selectmen's Association had a meeting in last
Thursday
at the Chandler's. We go all over the county and at different locations four times a year. And we were very fortunate to have the Secretary of Community Development or Development.
What is this? Secretary of Economic Development.
Economic Development. He has a lot of, actually, he's in charge of a lot of, but Economic, Jay Ash, he had a, I mean, it was very interesting to actually hear someone talk the way he did. And when I say that, it was talking non-political talk. Someone had asked about rail service up along the Route 2 corridor, commuter rail up through the Route 2, extending into like Charlemont and pass into North Adams and Adams, and he bluntly said, no, that's not going to happen. And that's, I thought it was a pretty refreshing.
No spin there, right?
Nope. No, but I wanted to drop back to him for one second. Because one of the things they talked about was education and Chapter 70 funding.
Yep.
And he said that the administration doesn't have a problem spending money, but it wants to see results. And they believe the state is spending a whole bunch of money and they're not seeing the results. They're not seeing results with money being spent in education. So basically, I think that's a shot across the board about how the money is spent. I did read something interesting in the Boston papers today about charter schools, and they're talking about how charter schools are less expensive than the schools that we run in our communities.
Really?
I don't think somebody has a full data on that.
Yeah, I would agree.
But I did think it was an interesting conversation because he's very blunt. And just so people understand, Jay is a Democrat in a Republican administration. And I just want to follow up.
Chelsea with
the retirement of Chief Gilbert, President of the Senate, Rosenberg was there, and actually Steve Kulik was there, and both have said working with this administration has been very good. So I think maybe we should heed what's being said.
That's a good point, actually. You're hearing it from the decision makers.
Correct.
And that's really may not necessarily like their politics, but when it's administration and finance, it's usually not a lot of politics, it's execution. It's formulaic, it's
numbers.
Policy versus politics. It's interesting.
Now, Jay didn't say what the administrators should want to see with education, so right. I don't know what that answer is.
Right.
And maybe that has to be defined.
Right. Well, you're right. You have to define your metrics before you can actually,
So maybe that has to be defined, and and that would be my first take, is that they have to define what they need to see or what they want to see.
Right. What are your idea of results? Yep.
Right. Good points. But I would hope that someone that runs our education, our learning, would maybe talk to the state and say, hey, what are you guys really looking for?
Yep.
I would think that
go ahead.
What they're talking about has to be
sort of region dependent too. You know, are they getting a bigger bang for their buck out here than they would be in the cities?
Well, that's a good point, right? Because it does vary.
I mean, that's a pretty broad brush to
yes.
paint the ed system.
Could be.
That happens a lot, though, from the state level. They have a lot of broad brushes in their art case.
I read the piece Tom was talking about today, and they were specific, not necessarily about Western Mass exclusively, but even inside of the traditional population density areas, you could have two communities that seem like they're completely disparate in the formula. How did that come about? And yet the distribution is such that formula inside the distribution works the same mechanics, and EQV comes into play, and attendance comes into play, and outgoing and ingoing go into play. So it's a little more noise when you chop the state up into pieces, but you can find our problem in Braintree. Yeah. Just the formula. It's how does it actually work out? And then you could go Braintree versus Newton. And it's like, so it, I can appreciate Secretary Ash's perspective about, you know, the aggregate distribution is still largest that they've ever put out, that the state's ever paid.
Yeah, like the total dollars.
The mechanics of the distribution may well be the point where we get most flustered about.
Yeah.
Good points, Tom. Good points. Okay, so, Sherry, anything else to cover before we plow into the warrant? All right, we'll do warrant first. We had voted last week to include some, and there are A through, and Bob, we've got these A through now.
I see that.
Yep, and we'll put numbers to them in the final draft. I think I'd like to leave tonight including the warrant either in total or amending, and then if it's possible, the easy ones to recommend. So again, the warrant's a living document. So when we come around to motions, the motions will be the next order of business for us. So we can start with A, it's a
motion.
This is include or recommend?
To recommend.
Okay.
This is to
I think we included
to both.
Include.
Yeah, to include.
Yeah. Second.
Okay, we got a move, motion made to include Article A. That's to hear the reports from boards and committees. Pretty straightforward. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. B is a prior invoice. And again, this is a money article, so and it's a prior invoice, and of course we have to prior year's invoice. We have to pay those. This is for $1,468.50. Is there a motion to include?
Motion.
Yeah, and second.
Okay, we have a motion made and seconded to include.
Motion to recommend.
So the first vote will be to include. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's 3-0? Aye. Okay. Sherry, do we have a funding source for this? Is this a free cash funding?
Free cash.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and again, this is a bill for legal services specific to the Sugarbush Meadow property. With ZBA, it's a $1,468.50 invoice. Is there a motion to recommend?
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and second to recommend. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. 3-0. Okay, so the next two were going to be salaries and then the budget. We're not going to go about the recommendations. We know we have to include these, though. Right?
Yes.
I'm going to look at the minutes just one more time. I want to make sure we didn't include. We're not doing.
We didn't.
We did not. Okay. So is there a motion to include Article C? Now, if we go about this, numbers. The numbers are in. Sherry, are these this year's numbers or last year's
numbers? Last year's numbers. I don't have the recommendations yet for this.
Okay. So can I make a suggestion that we take no action on C and D until next week, where we have the budget numbers complete and the funding sources complete.
Yep.
We have a personnel committee meeting this week, and that recommendation will be coming to us next. Okay, Tom, you all right with that?
Yep.
Okay, so now we're going on to E. That's capital stabilization. And again, we have a capital planning meeting coming this tomorrow, recommendation for the upcoming week. If I could, if it's a prerogative of the board, pass over this until next week. F is the funding sources for the capital budget by funding source. This is actually, Bob, this will be the working sheet we get. It's the request and then where it's coming from, what funding source. Budget driven and recommendation coming to the board. If it's a prerogative, we could pass over F until next week.
Yeah.
All right, Tom?
Yeah.
Okay. G, see if MGL work off abatement for... We did that one already last week. Now, this is a statutory adoption, an extension of a statutory adoption. Is there any reason we wouldn't consider... we have include recommended here as well.
Motion.
Yeah, second.
Okay. The motion is made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. And I see it's written down as 3-0 already, but maybe it's redundant. Special revenue fund for PEG access. Sherry, you want to give us a backdrop on this? This one here is the...
Yeah, I sent you the DOR, IGR on that. It's something that we're already doing. It creates a special revenue fund.
Okay.
So this is just formalizing it by having town meeting adopt it.
Okay. So we were doing it out of chapter and verse. The mechanics are being executed by chapter and verse. This is a town meeting adoption of the actual statute. Any discussion?
No. Motion.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. We included to recommend this last week. The question about funding source here. This will be...
I have a revised number for you. That number is $21,699.
Okay.
And that would be from free cash. Board so chooses.
Discussion. This is a student attending Smith Vocational, including transportation. There's no discussion. Is there a motion to recommend?
Motion.
Tom?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. So we got included and recommended. We
just have a question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, go ahead, Bob. I want to see if you're going to ask the same
it's
one.
It's in
I'm
the current
ask.
Fiscal year. Why isn't that an old bill?
Because it's ongoing now.
Yeah, students,
remember how we used to have the two different? We used to have a special town meeting and an annual town meeting.
Yeah.
So this is the current. Okay. We're still going to be in this fiscal year.
Okay.
There's only a couple of these. This is one, and then the attorney was one.
Yep. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. So is that your question too?
No, but actually, we're doing this out of free cash because of the. Well, for lack of a better word, irregularity of this, right?
Yeah.
Maybe just so folks know.
You wouldn't necessarily have a budget line item.
Right.
It's attendance by year.
And it's changed already since we've been discussing it. So.
Great we've point. Paid, do you want the breakdown? We've paid $6,567 of the transportation from the reserve fund. Hmm. So the balance is the $17,556 for tuition and $4,143. For the remainder of the year for transportation.
Okay, perfect. Thanks so much, Sherry. Mm-hmm. And again, that was reserve fund because the contractor simply wanted to get paid.
Yeah,
all of a sudden done. You've been transporting since September. You probably want to get paid.
So, just a point of clarification.
Uh-huh.
So, there's two costs. One is tuition, and the other one is transportation.
Yeah, right. Correct.
So, and that everybody gets that.
Yeah. If you're going out of district, you have to provide for a program that is not available in any district that we participate in. It's cost of attendance and transportation.
Transportation cost is $59.50 a day, and it's multiplied by the 180 days for the school year. So it's a little over, it's $10,710 for the school year.
Thank you.
You're welcome. No, it's a good line of questioning, only that again, it's... Superintendent Barrett was pretty clear about not having any trouble with educational opportunities outside of the district that are not available inside the district. That's truly what choice was driven towards. Okay. Now, the Article J, we have from the town accountant. We had appropriated last year the correct total sum. We had not broken the total sum down correctly. And part of it was a capital stabilization, sewer reserve, and the they were not broken apart. So the accountant has asked us to come back with this article to ensure that the appropriation passes audit muster. Yeah. And that's all this is revisiting last year's capital appropriation. Discussion?
I'll make a motion on that.
So this is no new money. This is last year's article being broken apart to ensure that we've got capital stabilization and sewer reserve reflected in the motion on the in the article on the from town meeting. So no new money here, just clearing up last year. Any discussion? Now, is there a motion to include and or recommend?
Motion both.
Second.
Okay. The motion's made and seconded to include and to recommend. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay. And now it gets a little sticky with K.
Yeah.
L, M, and N. Before we go on with these, Sherry, is there any more movement with respect to the Triangle property? And is it an alternate or is it one that we're going to put all four of these out in front of town meeting?
It is the board's prerogative. Mm-hmm. We have all of the sign-offs back.
These are all potential heirs. Okay.
So which one are you going to recommend? A?
A, yes. L? Mm-hmm.
So K is really, we don't need to look at K?
Is K the gateway, though, for taking action?
No, I think K was a placeholder. I don't believe we need K. A placeholder until town council had drafted the articles that we would be needing.
Okay. So isn't K a land swap, though, a separate action? K is about the old Ahern property.
No.
No?
No, that's M.
Okay.
That's M and N.
Yeah, I think that K was just the placeholder until we had the...
M and N just gone.
Okay.
Articles from council.
So L, K, and L were in reference to the triangle. The triangle piece.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep, parcel A, yeah.
Okay. And so now article L is what's been supplied by town council.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's got certainly a lot more meat to it than just the concept, which is in K.
Right. K basically say the public way, which mm-hmm. which it's not.
Okay, well, let's talk about L for just a second then. I'll pass on K for just to pass over K until.
Yeah, I think K, Scott, is M, either M or N. Is M and N the same thing, Sherry?
M is.
Both represent parcel B. Do you want to read them? Like, maybe that'll...
Yeah, go ahead, Dave. If you want to read them out loud.
Right through. Town Council's notes here.
Okay, I'll start with Article L, Parcel A.
To see well, hey, Dave, one second.
Yeah.
Do you actually have the map, Sherry? If you have the map, that may help describe it also.
I assume you'll have a handout on that.
Oh, yeah. So the cliff notes here are there are two parcels of property right here in School Street, the Mystery Triangle, which we have done deep title research on, contacted all of the potential heirs. There's like four families and about 260 heirs, but that's okay. I exaggerate, but it's not very far off of that. And an assessed value of, I think, $22,500, $22,600. The heirs have been contacted. A sum of money is being put aside in escrow in case they want to have their potential purchase of that piece taken, or I'm sorry, compensated for. The other piece is about a potential land swap, and that has to do with a piece of the Ahern, the old Ahern property over here has been sold, and part of that property is in the public way, and there's a question about would they be interested in having that donated in a land swap for some riverbank land. That is part of a contiguous plan for the pathway committees is working on that would allow for future river walks or other stuff.
The biggest thing is for the boat ramp.
Well, the boat ramp as well.
That's the number one thing right now. I mean, it may go down the road, but the biggest thing is the boat ramp.
Yep. So with respect to K, Dave, you want to plow through that one?
All right. Which is now like article replaced by Article L, Parcel A, to see if the town will vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to acquire by gift, purchase, and or eminent domain for general municipal purposes the fee simple to or a lesser interest in a parcel of land located on School Street, which parcel is shown as Parcel A on a plan entitled Existing Conditions, Plan of Land in Sunderland, Massachusetts, prepared for the town of Sunderland, dated February 16, 2015, prepared by Harold L. Eaton Associates, Incorporated, a copy of which plan is on file with the town clerk, and as funding for such acquisitions and costs related thereto to raise and appropriate, transfer from available funds, and or borrow any combination thereof, a sum of money, and further, to authorize the Board of Selectmen to enter into all agreements and execute on behalf of the town any and all such instruments as may be necessary or convenient to effectuate the purpose of this article, and further to authorize the Board of Selectmen to enter into all agreements and execute on behalf of the town any and all instruments as may be necessary or convenient to effectuate the purpose of this article or take any vote in relation thereto.
Okay. And Tom, you're saying that this is the triangle piece, correct?
I believe this is a triangle piece. Yeah.
Okay. So if that's the case, is there a question, discussion with respect to the triangle piece? There's two pieces here that are in play. And again, if the goal is to get the boat launch kick-started. And I say boat launch because, and it's important to bear in mind, you're not talking about the Oxbow Marina here. You're talking about motorless boats, effectively. Boats that can be launched in that side. So
it wouldn't be motorless, Scott. Yeah. People do put motor boats down through there.
Good point, Tom.
So not jet skis, because jet skis are not allowed by law. Mm-hmm. And motor boats are restricted to speed. Mm-hmm. You can't go over 15 miles an hour.
Yep. Through that space.
Yep. Or so says the law.
On paper.
Correct. So there is this article here with respect to Parcel A. Discussion about inclusion, first of all.
Scott, I'd rather not vote on any of them until we have one plan.
Yep.
And we don't have alternates and this and that. We just we have the map. We look at the map. Put the map up on the wall.
Yep. Okay. So here's A and here's B.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I can do that for the next meeting.
Sure. Yeah.
So the value of that piece is $22,500. We have the releases from all the owners known, but we have to set aside 20% of that amount for 3 years for in case any owners unknown come forward. So that one's pretty clear. It's when we get into the next ones and the encroachment that it gets a little muddier.
Okay. That's under B.
Right.
So the value is established on that one at $22,500.
Right.
We had an appraisal done. We used the people that had done some appraisals for us in the past. Mm-hmm. They've been very, their appraisals have been good. So, you know, some people may question the value of the land, but I can say that when we look at what we're getting $18,000 from the state to do other work, which is going through, it's all going to be pretty much a wash. Plus the DCR is putting in the boat ramp. They're doing all the construction costs and everything. Right. I think we're plus we're going to get handicap parking down there. So handicap, if you're a handicapped person, you want to use the river, they're going to give you access down the river. I think those are all plus things.
In and of itself is a plus. Good right. point, Tom.
Tidy it all up. It'll be very nice.
Okay, so we'll hold off on A. You want to go about reading B and alternate, or you want to just hold off on this discussion entirely?
Let's not confuse anybody.
Okay.
Because we're confused right now.
Right. Okay, so we'll jump down to O, right? There's a particle A and a, I'm sorry, parcel A and parcel B. We're going to put our homework together and get after this for our next meeting. The next article is CPA, Undesignated Budgeted Reserve. Dave, you want to read this one?
Yeah. Article, right now, O, to see if the town will vote to appropriate $50,000 from the CPA Undesignated Budgeted Reserve Fund, the restoration and preservation of a 1925 Rio fire truck. Said funds to be expended under the direction of the Sunderland Volunteer Firemen's Association and the Community Preservation Committee. That was recommended 5-0 by the CPC committee.
Okay. Motion to include and or recommend.
Motion both.
Aye. 3-0, please. Okay, so that's these are the CPA.
What's the vote on that, Scott? 3-0?
3-0, yep. That's to include and to recommend. The next CPA article is another CPA article. And this has to do a little bit with this recreational area, kind of tying what we're talking about earlier. And so this one's $36,631.
We can read these if we want, they're short.
Yeah.
This is to see if the town will vote to appropriate $36,631 from the CPA Undesignated Budget Reserve Fund to phase one of a riverfront recreation area, said funds to be expended under the direction of the Community Pathways Committee. And that was recommended 7-0 by the CPC committee.
We've got a recommendation here. It must be to include. Okay. Is there a recommendation? Is there a motion to recommend?
Motion.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. We have another CPA coming right after that, David.
To see if the town will vote to appropriate $52,000 from the CPA Historic Preservation Reserve Fund to fund preservation and the restoration of the Riverside Cemetery, said funds to be expended under the direction of the Riverside Cemetery trustees, and that was recommended 7-0 by the CPC committee.
Okay, I'll hold off on my vote on this only, and then I'm also elected on that body. So is there a motion to include and recommend?
Motion.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, but I thought this was like a 3-year plan.
It is 3 years, but the appropriation isn't this year. The expenditure of the funds will go out over the course of 3 years.
Okay. I just I don't think that's...
Maybe we mentioned that when we talk about it.
Well, it's right. I mean...
So that.
I think you go back and think about it. It says, well, if it's occurring over 3 years, why is it?
Do you want to do it all at once? Or?
No. Yeah, well, why put all the numbers together? I guess there's a reason for that. I guess it doesn't matter.
There is a good point. Are you suggesting that future, any multi-year CPA should be based on the plan and the appropriation happens that year?
Or we're defining, maybe we define in the motion how the money is to be used.
Oh, that's a good point.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know.
To be spent over 3 years.
Yeah. And it's pretty easy. You could put out whether it's this one or even the one above it for the riverfront action. It's still going to be multiple years.
That's what's getting me to thought, you know. It's like, well, how do you know things don't change? And I guess that would be the CPC's committee would have the overview of that. So maybe that's okay.
Right, like whichever one's designated as the oversight.
But for the appropriation, Tom, you raise a good point. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No,
you raise a good point. The handout for the CPA submission to go to town meeting should be part of the handout.
It could.
You know, what does it mean? Mm-hmm. So we're appropriating, use the cemetery for example. You're appropriating $52,000 from CPA to be spent over 3 years. There's another $100,000 that's matched from a bunch of different areas that are part of the big project. So the way this article reads is like, oh, the CPA is spending $52,000. It sounds like they're the only player. Now, again, this is an appropriation article, but the backstory is going to be the most important part of it.
And you're right. When I look at the three CPA articles, there's a lot more involved with CPA articles than what's being put on paper.
Right.
So you look at the Rio.
Yep.
Oh, we're $50,000. Well, there's nothing about the commitment that the volunteer fire department put to raise, $30,000?
Their own, exactly.
Right. That they're going to come up with also.
Yep.
There's nothing in the cemetery about what the trustees are going to put in. There's nothing in the pathways about where other monies are coming for that also. So
I can see that as supporting documentation.
Mm-hmm.
But to put that inside of the article could make it just as confusing if it's not appropriation.
Yeah.
So I hear you though.
But if you go to the post office and read the warrant, what's it telling?
Yeah, we're gonna appropriate $100,000 in a CPA for these three things. That's what it says. Right.
But it's not telling you that we're leveraging this. It's not telling you that the CPC is actually using CPA money to leverage these projects.
No, you raise a good point.
So they're not basically doing the whole CPC isn't doing, or CPA money isn't doing the whole project.
Right.
It's we're leveraging money, which is the way it should be used.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Absolutely.
Plus, it's probably in some ways, I like a better word, safer if you're doing, rather than doing that appropriation every year. If you know, okay, I'm going to spend X amount over 3 years, because there's no guarantee from year to year, not that it's ever happened before, that the state is going to actually appropriate what they claim they're going to appropriate.
Yeah,
that's
a good point. Yeah, you don't know. So it's funny. And again, when I go back and look at our CPA projects, we've been pretty good that the CPA money has been used to leverage bigger projects than what's been spent. And that usually doesn't happen.
Yeah, it's usually straight retail.
Right.
So I'm wondering if, it's just brainstorming some suggested language for future CPA events, CPA articles. So again, town meeting is the appropriating body, but this could read, to see if the town will vote to appropriate $52,000 from the CPA Historic Preservation Reserve Fund to fund its portion of blank, $150,000+,
right, the
3-year plan. So the appropriation is caught in the language, but it also spells out that the CPA is only funding a part of it.
Yeah, well, we can do. I'll bring it back to the CP.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about future language. Mm-hmm.
But I think we shouldn't be afraid. We should be letting our residents know that the CPC is actually we're leveraging that CPA money to do good things.
Right. So somehow incorporate it as its portion of the total. That's all it is. That's the appropriation part. And then some narrative that says other funds include da 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 da. But then it gets fuzzy around the appropriation process.
Why I say that is because, you know, was it last year, 2 years ago, when we appropriated the money for the playground?
Yep.
Okay. The only thing some people saw was the dollar amount that the CPA or CPC was recommending to put CPA money into the project.
Right, as opposed to total project cost.
They didn't see the total project cost.
Right.
Same could be said for the Merritt softball field.
Mm-hmm.
We knew there was $25,000, whatever that dollar amount was, but we didn't see all the in-kind donations. and how that was leveraged to put that ball field together. So we're kind of selling the projects short because, you know, again, Merritt Ball Field was $24,000-$25,000. And I would honestly say if you told people that you could put together a ball field with dugouts and fence and electricity and water and this and that for $25,000, they would say you're full of
right
hooey. Okay. But if you looked at what the in-kind donation and or, you know, when you had J.S. Ray that came down and they did the direct bore and they only charge you X amount of dollars instead of blah, 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 we're not capturing for people to see.
Well, it's kind of like Francis always mentions too, is that you're not capturing that volunteer labor too. All that other, like all the folks who are out there working on the playground, things like that too, you know?
Look.
And that's hard to...
The one thing I learned... And I need to digress for one second.
You go right ahead.
The one thing I learned last week at the South County EMS meeting, that we're lucky in the town of Sunderland. And I'll tell you why. Of course, I was going to tell you. if someone has an idea, okay, the Board of Selectmen in our town, and it's been this for a while, will help make that idea come to fruition. But the person or people that came up with that idea actually lead that project or idea. They don't sit back and pontificate and accept someone else to do the work for them. Mm-hmm. So when the Zacharys and others came up with the idea about the playground, when Shauna was thinking about, and her contact was talking about the softball field, when in the trustees of the cemetery talked about, they didn't just come up with those ideas and expect that it was somebody else was going to do it. They did it.
Right. They championed the project all the way through.
They championed the project. They and they looked to the board and the town to assist, to help things happen, but they didn't expect the board to do everything.
Right.
I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful to our residents that they understand that they're not afraid to roll up their sleeves and get things done and not expect the three people sit up on the Board of Selectmen to do everything, because we can't.
Right.
And that's one thing I learned from South County EMS at a meeting the other night, mm-hmm. that we're fortunate to live in our town because we have people, Pathways Committee. Look mm-hmm. at the Pathways Committee, how long they've been meeting,
yeah.
Okay? To come and finally after years, this is finally starting to come to fruition. The selectmen helped. Our town administrators, Margaret and Sherry, have helped. Mm-hmm. They've been able to offer guidance. When, I mean, how many emails has Nancy picked written Sherry, you know? But we're there to help, and we're helped to move the projects forward. But if our residents think it's a good idea, then we think it's a good idea, and we offer that support. I'm happy that we're like that. I'm glad that they're not looking at us to do everything, because we wouldn't be where we were today if it was left us to us, because we can only do so much.
Right. No, you raise a good point. We act in many ways as kind of a steering kind of object, you know? How to make sure things get done so nobody goes to jail. A, right? And then B, as facilitators, whether it be finances or tying together with legal services or et cetera. Absolutely right, Tom.
And again, I can go back to the public library. And again, you may agree or disagree with the library, what it was built, when it was built, how much it was built for. But once our town decided to do it, it was that committee that led it. Public Safety Complex. Okay, it was a committee that had that together. They're the ones that moved it together. The only project that didn't happen that way was rebuilding of the elementary school, mm-hmm. and that was just because we didn't have that time, and decisions had to be made during that day, And unfortunately, the Board of Selectmen, or fortunately, depends on how you look at it, the Board of Selectmen was sitting at that time. We had to do a lot of that stuff. But for the most part, we've been very lucky. I'd like to thank the residents, all the residents that get involved and help us with that thing, you know? Because if you just want the Board of Selectmen to do everything, it can't happen. But we've done a lot of great things because we've had a lot of great people do a lot of great things.
I agree, it's a good point. And the catalyst about the multi-town discussion was pretty obvious.
Yeah, for me it was.
Although we do lift a lot of shovels and hammers and stuff.
That's a good point, David.
But that's the way it goes.
Davey, most of us our homes today wouldn't be the homes that we had today if it wasn't for sweat equity.
Mm-hmm. That is very true.
Right?
I have some pictures on my phone. I can show that.
Right? I mean, Bob, you look at how many. I know Bob. I've known Bob since he was Mr. Doobie to me back in grade school. But how many? I mean, that's what you did, right? I mean, you took a house and you worked on it and you made it better and you made small improvements and your house ended up being a better place. Sweat equity. Mm-hmm. You know?
That's how it works.
I think so. We all done it.
Some of us. And still doing it.
I've been working on mine for 35 years. So.
Always a work in progress.
I don't know. I was thinking about that the other day and I was just looking at the CPA and the CPAs are prime examples. And again, you look at the Rio for the fire department, you know, those guys they made a huge commitment. And the CPC let it be known, look, we can't pay for the whole thing. And they made a huge commitment for the restoration, come up with $30,000. And that's a lot of hard work on their part. Mm-hmm. That's not going to count all the other things that they, you know, that $30,000 is one port. It doesn't count all the other things that they're getting from sweat equity on that also. So again, I just think, you know, people should look in the mirror and say, you know, you guys have done a good job over there.
All those initiatives.
Yeah.
I mean, the initiatives to come forward, as you said, Tom, we're fortunate.
All right. So maybe at some point we can redefine this a little bit and we can get more credit to the projects.
It's part of the warrant. It's part of the warning.
Yeah. Somehow. Yeah.
Yeah.
And again, it says some people just see the $100,000. They don't know it really is a $180,000 project.
Right.
You know? And I think they should
see all of it. And again, I think the...
Somehow. I don't know what the right way is, Scott.
Yeah. But.
So back to we're on the article Q.
This is Q. Yep.
All in favor? We're there? Are we at that point of it?
We're at that point. Yep.
Scott, you were abstaining from that?
Yeah, I'm abstaining. As a trustee. Yeah. Now the general fund for the upcoming year. Now there's been back and forth with the Department of Revenue and our estimating of this. And Chair, these represent the newest numbers.
Correct.
Based on the percentages. But what's happened in the past is we've contemplated the match. And the state has suggested, actually through our accountant's inquiry, if we contemplate the match at 100%, which we've been very fortunate and have gotten, and it comes in less than that, that's an ugly kind of mechanism where you revisit the following year. So the Department of Revenue guidelines now, or guidance to the town accountant, was you recommend that we anticipate a 70% match, and if there's excess, that's fine. That's different than having it be a deficit.
Yeah. And based on historic precedent, I think that's a wise...
Right. Yeah. Right. So again, we're in a position to have the 100% match, and the state has given us 100% match. However, anticipating that revenue and putting it in the warrant article and having it fall short could mean action in a future town meeting. So these numbers have been pulled down a little bit on the budgeted, undesignated budgeted reserve.
You want a motion?
Yeah.
A motion to include and recommend. That's our CPA housekeeping.
Well,
it's
an important piece though, because it allocates by percentage by the statute that this town has adopted, right?
Yep.
And then puts those monies designated historic, designated housing, designated open space, and undesignated altogether, and that is essentially the appropriation for the upcoming year.
It's a good reminder too, because I think sometimes you forget, you know, there's more than one category.
Exactly. You know, you have to write those categories each year.
All right, go ahead, Bob. You have another question.
What are the administrative costs?
They can. Part of the thing is that they can hire the CPC can hire a secretarial or admin type assistants.
Because they have some accounting work and things like that that they have to have done each year. So
one of the Bob, if you think about it this way, the administrative expenses that are allowed to be captured under the CPA, had they not been broken out, would be caught in the omnibus expense budget under the town's administration. So one of the benefits of applying not the full cap, but a value, affords some administrative assistance directly to the CPC through the CPA funds, as opposed to general government.
$6,000 sounds like a lot of money.
Part-time job.
Compared to planning board and what you guys do.
You raise a good point, Bob.
Well, I would say that unless you sit in a CPC meeting, yeah,
there's a lot of volumes of paper down there.
Like, how do you can you use CPA money for the restoration of the Rio? That has to be researched. Can you use it for the cemetery? You know, the Sunderland Volunteer Fire Department Association, DSVFA or whatever, is going to do the restoration. Well, can you give money to the restoration to somebody that's not really the town? It is the town, but not the town. Mm-hmm. There's a whole bunch of work that goes into the CPC, that where the money can be spent and how it's spent. And I know Brian spends a whole bunch of time, and I know Jennifer Uncles. Mm-hmm. I have no idea where she found the time to do what she does on, and Richard, those two. It's amazing the time that both of them spend on the CPC. They don't get the money though. The CPC has actually hired someone, and it's not a lot. It's not many hours a month or so to help out with that. Keep everything.
Some of the research.
Well, because it covers, when you look at the categories, if you look at like the planning board, they have a very narrow focus. Whereas here, you're touching a lot of aspects of town government. So it can bring in a lot of different legal issues and things like that, and gobs of paperwork.
Big binders.
Projects.
See, on the planning board, I fought for 25 years that we probably needed some type of full-time planning. Not full-time, but some assistance in planning. But we've never been able to bring that. I think we're very lucky on the planning board that we have people that do what they do. I mean, I was on the planning board with you. I mean, and we had Dr. Lane. If it wasn't for Dr. Lane doing the check and the T's were crossed and the I's were dotted, I mean, he was our, yeah. Right? I mean, it was a lot of work. I agree. And I still say our zoning board, just look at the zoning board with all the issues that they have with the sugar bush project. Those guys, they could probably give classes on that. Mm-hmm. And what kind of compensation they get. Most of the time when we tell somebody, oh yeah, zoning board, you'll have maybe one or two meetings a year. Right? They were doing one or two meetings a week.
And there were heady meetings.
Wow. Yeah. Not like Concom too, those guys, you know, you're out tromping around in fields and filling out paperwork and doing soil tests.
We're very fortunate, like I said, Bureau, we're very fortunate. We have some very good people in town.
had one question here on reserves, and there's no allocation set aside for housing.
Because we could, well, the one thing that you guys, is that it, when, what the reserve means is that by law, you have to, every year, you have to say, you have to have 10% of your estimated, 10% of your revenue has to go for historic preservation, 10% for open space preservation, 10% for community housing, okay? The community housing is covered under 120 North Main Street.
Right. We used it for that.
At the top.
And so what, it's about $25,000. So we cover, so we're covering that 10%. It's very good.
Yep.
So you have to have at least, so this year, the historic resource reserve, the open space. So what basically it's saying is that you can't spend all your money on renovating a house, yep, or you have to set aside so much every year.
Got it.
Okay. I'm going to make sure we're not missing anything. I know appropriating it makes perfect sense.
It just ended up, it ended up with the 120 North Main was perfect for filling in that 10% every year.
Perfect. That's a good point. Okay.
Just as a heads up on this community housing reserve, I've run into some folks that have been wondering what's happening with Sophie's house. Are you going to mention anything about that on town meeting floor?
In your
reports?
Certainly can, as part of the, not only the written report for the annual, but we can certainly talk about its current status.
An update. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty straightforward. We're working with a grant round to help with designer developed selection. And the grant, did we get that? Actually,
yes, we don't have the formal award letter, but we have a verbal award.
Okay.
Nice. So folks were just wondering what's,
sure,
where, right, what's going on.
Yep, yep, raise a good point. Yeah, the recommendation has gone through to the board, and now the board is working with that grant round for develop and design. Best way to go about that, frankly, it's the RFP process.
It's one of those projects that takes a while, too. So, you know, there's these gaps as you're going through the different phases where it doesn't seem like much is going on, but.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. Okay, so with respect to the reserves, we have these highlighted here. We had motions to include. Is there a motion to recommend? And this is going to be Article R.
Article R.
3-0. Do we have a value yet for 300th anniversary? Not yet?
We have to ask Tom Z.
Okay. So we're going to recommend.
They're meeting on Wednesday, I think.
Okay.
Oh, we can do that next week then?
Yep. We can plug that value in. So I'm looking here at our minutes to make sure we're not doing redundant. And I don't, is there a motion to include?
Motion. Got a,
for them there, so.
For
T?
For S, motion just to include.
Okay, motion, second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Okay, so we got it included, we got to plug a value in. Okay. T is a, again, a request of the combination of the accountant and the library trustees. And there is a building fund that was a part of the original appropriation back in, God, it seems like 1998 seems like a long time, doesn't it? But anyway, a long time when the fund was created, and it had to do with the construction and maintenance functions and future capital, right? And what we're looking to do with this article is amend that 1998 article, allowing the trustees and friends of the library to have access to the building fund and change it to an expendable trust. And I'll get the better cliff notes of that from Lauren Starr. Her and I spoke about it. It was, again, the availability of the trustees to expend the last of that fund now that the building is built and in many years in service.
Is it still the new library, though? 1998.
It's always going to be the new library.
Are we going to say, when does it become the old library?
Yeah, exactly.
Probably when there's nobody around who was here when the other one was here.
Sunderland Public Library.
I asked Brian if he wanted me to change that, yeah. And he said that's the way that the library trustees voted it, so... Hmm.
Maybe at some point we need to remind the trustees, not them, but that it's no longer
the new library.
It's a Sunderland Public Library.
Good point.
Do you want me to check and see if maybe we can?
And it doesn't bother me. It bothers me that we still call it the new library because, as Scott says, 1998 was 20 years ago.
Yeah, but Tom, the new school has been paid off twice.
I know.
It's still the new school to a lot of people.
I know.
The dollars are already there.
Yeah,
this,
yeah.
This is just going to allow them to access them.
Yep.
You know, this is really a housekeeping thing brought about by...
The accountant. The trustees asked for access to the funds for, I think the last piece was signage, and there was a little him and hawing, and this was the easiest to go back there and just clean up the language of the original... creation of the fund. You're just defining the fund. Okay. Any discussion?
No.
If not, is there a motion to include and or recommend?
Motion.
We have a motion made. Second. All those in favor?
All right.
3-0, please. And consent articles, I think we are...
We did these.
Okay, sure. That was a wide swath. Now again, we have the consent articles. Motion, Mr. Pierce, second. I'm looking at the minutes from last week, so we have those in place. Okay, so again, the warrant's a living document. Bob, do you see anything extraordinary that's going to jump out? Some clarification, the CPA I can certainly appreciate. We'll have to have our homework complete on the piece about the funds, if that makes sense. The rescinding of one makes sense. And there's only two bills to pay in the current year.
Usually there's a little more.
Yeah, just to call your attention, Scott, to Y. Article Y. That one's new. So you haven't voted that one. I just got it.
Okay, let's see.
What's that?
South County EMS, Article Y.
Is that an annual now?
Is that going to be a recurring thing, or is it a one-time deal?
Yeah, under, because it is here with the
consent
articles.
Yeah, I wasn't sure where.
Oh,
it's just because I just got it. I can move that if.
Yeah.
That'd be a one-time thing. Basically, I think Doug from the town of Deerfield figured it out because the way it was voted. Under Mass General Law Chapter 30 something or other, mm-hmm. what it was, the Board of Selectmen, instead of everything having to go to town meeting, is really there are still certain items that have to be done, like location, that would have
adding
to be done,
a new community,
and the budget has to be done by mm-hmm. the town meeting, mm-hmm. but for main, you know, the other day-to-day running portions of the South County EMS, it's really supposed to be done by the Board of Selectmen, mm-hmm. according to the Mass General Law.
Okay.
As I understand
it. So is this, Tom, the tension between the structure of South County EMS and the way the law currently reads? I don't mean tension in the worst way. I mean just something that has to be revisited?
No, he's just recommending it to make it conform to the general law.
Okay, so is that going to be?
I think it's really more clarification as well.
Okay, so let me ask the question. It's right now tied in with the consent article. Should this be moved out and be a standalone?
I would think so. Yeah, I'll make a motion to recommend it and everything.
Yep.
But let's get it out.
Get ahead of the consent articles. Yeah.
Okay. Just so it's not in there.
Okay. So you have a motion to include and recommend it?
Yeah.
And is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion's made to include and recommend. We'll call it Article Y for right now, but it's going to be something else. This has to do with South County EMS intermunicipal agreement primarily. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. I see another one highlighted back here, Sherry. Is this a new fund? Is that what this is about?
This is for the highway shared equipment for the bucket truck.
Mm-hmm.
And that agreement references a revolving fund.
Yep.
So that's why you see it here now.
Do we have to have that as a function of town meeting, or is it just an accountant?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you have annually.
The town council was in the back.
Revolving fund.
Got it. Okay. So is it an appropriate location for this to be in the consent articles?
Yeah.
Okay. So we need to, this is different. We need to add this. Is there a motion to include and recommend the highway shared equipment article as it's presented in the consent articles?
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay. Because it's a revolving fund, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Inspection, Board of Health, Fall Festival Committee. Is a Fall Festival Committee supposed to still be in there? I thought we had outed that. There is not one. We're not having one this year.
I don't know that. Do you know that?
That's a good point, actually. The revolving fund still exists. Let's not.
Right.
I would be just like, you know, it'd be just perfect. We have a really super successful fall festival and no town meeting appropriation and no fund.
Right.
Okay. Sorry about that. Okay. So with respect to the warrant, we got essentially the budget articles and the land alternates, the A's and B's for next week. Anything else? Okay. If not, let's take a topical look at the budget. Sherry's been doing the hardest work of the administrators this time of year, looking at 356 lines that we see. It has nothing to do with all the accounts and the accountants lines. And Sherry, you've been working on this a little bit.
Yeah,
and is there dramatic changes?
No, what you'll see is I backed out any salary increases pending recommendations from the Personal Advisory Committee and board approval. And I also, under the expense line items for highway, fuel, and for the building, I backed those out. The fuel, just to level fund it.
Mm-hmm.
The fuel costs have come down. The electric's coming down. I think that they'll be fine, level funded. And we have the energy contingency if something should go.
Yeah.
So it brought it down to an overall 1.5% increase.
Is this something you want to meet with department heads on before we run right through?
I have a meeting scheduled for next Thursday with the department heads.
So will we be in a position to have them warned about the proposed budget versus what was submitted?
Right.
Okay.
And I did ask Brendan to take a look at the police wages with regard to the new hires and some different movement there.
So if you look at the highlighted sections by category, again, we get right to the bottom, we have the big nut, of course, is education this year. There's no doubt about that. I'm talking with Steve Kulik on the way out on the event on Saturday. He mentioned that he had heard from you, Tom, about the pressure in the budget this year, 10% at the elementary and an aggregate total of 4.2, but it's what's lost in there is a bunch of out of district outplacement, which you know, as I said to Steve,
it happens.
You know, we're paying for kids in the building from the town.
Yeah.
Okay, kind of get it.
It's the nature of the beast, I guess.
Well, I think it would be interesting to once again send. And we haven't done it the last couple of years, but I think to me that it's no greater than the first line on the top of the page, line 2 and 3. And what our 2.5% growth is, mm-hmm. which is $116,166. And the new growth, which is $34,171, that's $34,171 is the amount of money that we're collecting this year that wasn't available for us to collect last year. Mm-hmm. So if you add those two up, and again, right off the top of my head, it's like $150,000
total. Yep.
So if you're strictly to follow the 2.5 guideline, our ability to increase total budget is $150,000. Mm-hmm. So, and I don't know how to say this without people taking it the wrong way. Just because you point something out doesn't mean you're pointing out for a specific reason. Right.
Exactly. It's just the point of the fact.
If your total revenue intake increases by $150,000 and you have one component mm-hmm. that increase, and again, that part of the budget's like 30-35% of the budget. Mm-hmm. To begin with, it's a big part of our budget. But if that goes up $210,000, we start $60,000 in the hole.
Right. That's absolutely right.
And
that's just math.
Right. Yeah.
Well, you know, that makes me think of something else going back to an earlier topic that you mentioned too. Now, the state said they paid out the biggest dollar amount towards mm-hmm. education. Mm-hmm. But that's only a tiny piece of the puzzle, because while they may have been spending more dollars over X number of years on, let's say, education, the amount that the state is putting in over that same time has gone down. To look strictly at dollars when you're addressing it is to miss another big part of the picture too.
Nuances. Whether it's purposely missed or
exactly, you
know, pleasantly avoided.
Right.
Good points.
And the difference for us, if you're looking at the numbers, besides a perfunctory overview, mm-hmm. if you really look at the numbers, you have to say that. And again, I guess the point is that if you continue to have increases of 210, and I'm not saying it happens every year, and that's not what I'm trying to say. It's not a specific discussion. It's just a discussion I think that we have to have. But if you're increasing $210,000 in one segment of your population, or one that's 35%. Mm-hmm. That means the other 70% of your budget, 65% of your budget, can have no increases, and you still don't have the revenue to cover.
Right.
That's all I'm trying to say.
Yeah, you got one area of
growth. Just a numbers issue.
Huh?
It's just a numbers issue in that respect. You know what I mean?
Right. So how now someone has to ask, well, how do you make it happen? Mm-hmm. Well, one thing is that a couple of years ago we voted the capital stabilization. Mm-hmm. And we'll discuss capital stabilization. So if we didn't have that, we'd be really, yep. it would be really difficult for us to even consider how to meet our capital mm-hmm. requirements that we have coming up.
Right.
We have what we call free cash. Mm-hmm. Free cash. It's still money that we paid, taxpayers paid in, and we're lucky to have free cash. Now, some towns will just rack up free cash and keep putting it away. I was told when I first became a selectman that we fought a war over taxes without representation. And if you have $1 million in free cash, then you're taxing us too much. I believe that. Mm-hmm. You know, we want to have a firm grasp of what we're charging. So we don't have $1 million, because if we had $1 million, that means our taxpayers are giving us that money, mm-hmm. and we don't want their money if we don't need it. So we have to do a better job in we've cut, we've done a lot, we've been very tight in a lot of areas. And sometimes we have to figure out how to get these swings from happening and understanding what those swings do to our budgets.
You raise a really good point, Tom. And we're at $2.1 odd million dollars, just the elementary school, $2.297, $2.376 this year, $219,000 when you only have growth on the revenue side of $150,000 done. And this is effectively the baseline for next year, which is a whole different budgeting discussion, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Because it's not particularly cyclical unless you don't pass an override, then it's really cyclical. But
man, again, I just think it should be part of our discussion. It mm-hmm. should be part of our discussion. And it's a hard discussion, but people shouldn't be afraid of that discussion.
Right.
And we need to have that discussion.
Mm-hmm. It's also one of the mechanical elements, of course, that we know because of our proximity to the budget, is you can look, Bob, at the back page, and go, oh well, geez, that's where you got breathing room this year. Debt's down $93,000. That's all excluded. So it just comes off the rate. It doesn't help with the operating budget.
It's not like it's cash thrown back in. Exactly. Right.
And once that debt goes away, and that comes off the tax rate. So we have very little of that. That's simply allowed to do with expenses. I'm sure you're going to continue working on the expense side. Everything else, if you go down by category, 5% for the accountant has to do with a piece of software, 1% total assessors, 0.8%. Total treasurer collector, elections and registrations, big jump this year. All that, two sets of elections. That yeah. goes down next year. Minus 81% next year will look good. This year, 81% looks big.
That's a real cyclical
right.
thing.
Right, that's absolutely cyclical. 0%, 0%. These are categories now. Total boards and committees, total town buildings. 6% for total police, and that's to be reviewed. We have one open piece of under labor, under wages, we have to take a look at. Minus 13% for a fire department, that specifically has to do with we don't have an ambulance service here anymore. We have an assessment from SCEMS. Total town inspectors, 4% has to do with one-time code updates. Pretty straightforward. 0% for remaining protection. Highway, 0.6%. These are increases I'm talking about. Total health and sanitation, down 0.13%. Total library, 0%. Total schools, even with our total composition of our schools, our total makeup, 4.2%. And Tom, even with the reductions, there's, if you look at the total schools change from prior year to this, there's all of our growth.
Well, and
that's all of education.
Well,
right, that 159,000.
See, and this is where numbers are tough because Franklin County Tech.
Yep.
People have to remember.
Yep.
Franklin County Tech is purely by assessment. You got 9 students going.
Yep.
There, you have 10 students there, 11 students, whatever. However many you have,
like,
is what you pay.
Yep.
This year we're down $60,000.
3 students.
Okay.
Yep.
Last year we were paying 156 to Franklin Tech or 158,000. This year we have 97,000.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
It could go right back up. Yep. It could double next year.
Yep.
Right. And then we've got the Smith student. Smith. So that is
right.
an add-on we didn't have before.
Right.
So
plus you could have veterans moving in. That's another category that's very mm-hmm.
I hope people are on record. You know, we're going to be able to this year's budget. We'll be able to handle because, you know, Frontier they reduced their budget by $250,000 by adding $250,000 from their E&D account towards their receipts. Well, if they don't put that in next year, guess what?
Right.
Yeah, up the budget.
Structurally, they didn't change the expenses.
Right, structurally, they didn't change anything. Right.
So you still got to pay for them.
And a couple years ago, Frontier eliminated all their E&D mm-hmm. Contributions to to the receipt. So we had a big increase.
Right.
A couple, but Bob understands.
Yeah. Right.
You know, we're
awful close.
We're walking up. Boy, I hate to, even when we have a good year, we're still.
It's still a tight year. When all said and done, it's still a tight year.
So if we could, sorry, Scott.
No, don't apologize. I think it's important to talk through. If we go to the tax recaps and cherry sheets, it's nice not to see a red number, but it's also not a very big number. It looks like when all is said and done, we have the ability to have $32,000 maybe left over headed toward free cash the next year. So again, levy, cherry sheets, local receipts, pretty straightforward. We're going to use assessor's overlay for the first time in a number of years, at least 4 years. And again, the assessor's overlay is they're going to assess $25,000 extra anyway this year. Just happens to go back and we ask the assessors if there's any available funds, and there are some available monies, which coincidentally is pretty close to the net left over.
Yeah, that's true.
Right? And then, of course, the assessments. There is a wild card at the bottom of this page. All those red numbers in the far right column. We haven't got a state budget yet. We're still
working with the governor's proposed.
So there's volatility right there on the cherry sheet offsets in particular and state assessments.
Well, actually, I think Steve was saying, and Dan both were saying the other day, that those are pretty safe numbers.
Yeah. I had the same comment as we were heading out.
You know, we did have the although I did address Stan as Mr. President.
Okay. Well, Sherry, thanks so much for your work on both the budget as well as the revenue sheets. Although this is not your first budget by any stretch of the imagination, it's yours here with us, so we're still going to work through that.
Well, the good news is we don't have to have a Prop 2.5 question this year.
This year, that's correct. Okay. So, Bob, one more visit of the warrant and then motions, and we should be in pretty good shape. Knock on wood. No big bylaw changes. No pooper scooper laws. Always ruckus. Okay.
Our report should be done.
Yeah, right.
Are you going to move on to something besides the warrant or town meeting?
Today?
No.
Public comment.
What's that?
Public comment.
Yeah, otherwise, we're done.
Just a quick question.
Sure.
Who's the guy? I know his name is, I believe, Mike. This heads up the Cub Scouts or the Boy Scouts.
Dave Mateo.
Mike Zioli.
What is it?
Well, Mike.
He's participating.
Mike Zioli's a map like scout master, but the main scout master, David Teal, I believe.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thiel.
Oh, yeah.
I was just. You need his email address or something?
Have you got it? You got access?
I actually have it on. Oh. I have it on my phone, but I left my phone at home.
I did the same thing. Same thing. We can certainly get it for you, Bob. So April 9th at number 7 South Main Street is the last day to register to vote down here. That's going to be at an assistant clerk's office. And that's if you registered for the annual town meeting and the annual town election, of course.
Wednesday night.
The 11th at 6:30 is our next meeting. The 18th is Patriots Day, which means the offices are going to be open 14 hours out of patriotism. No, offices are closed. I know. The 29th, of course, is the annual town meeting at the Sunderland Elementary School down there, 7 o'clock. And the following Saturday, May 7th, of course, is the annual town election. So for all of the folks who are in and around, please go down to the town meeting. It's always good stuff. And it's your democracy to give up if you choose not to participate. That would make everybody sad. Any comments of the board?
Just Drive carefully. It's getting cold tonight and icy, but hopefully it'll be gone.
The nice part is you took all the sandbags and shovels out of all the trucks last week, got them ready for highway, highway tires put on them. We're ready.
There you go.
Never fails. Okay. If there's no other discussion, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion. Second.
Motion's made and seconded. We have a third. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye, Captain.
8 o'clock, please call us out. Terry said we'd be done.